Welcome to the panel discussion, the last track, or the last session in the architectures you've always wondered about track. This panel discussion is a little self-indulgent, I admit. I work in real-time systems and have for a while. And I think, Astrid's talk, the very first talk in this track, talked about the thinking of the electrical grid as a distributed system, and how are we going to manage all these renewable devices on the electrical grid? That's inherently a real-time problem. So our shift to these really event-based real-time systems is out of necessity. It's not just a fad. Same thing in the work that I do. If we think of ride sharing or if we think of financial transactions, these things are all like very real-time event-based systems. And we've heard a lot about, I think, success in the transition to these systems, but often we don't hear about some of the real hard parts, especially in living with these systems, I think, over time. So that's what I want to focus this panel discussion on. But let's start with introductions. I guess I'll go start with myself. I'll try and be a kind of unbiased panel host, but I think I'll probably actually have a few opinions, and I'm going to be curious about a few subjects. So I'm Colin Breck. I lead the cloud platforms team at Tesla in the energy division, and mainly focused on real-time services for battery charging and discharging, solar power generation, and vehicle charging. Maybe Sergey, you can introduce yourself.
Thank you, Colin. Pleasure to be here. I'm Sergey Bykov. Currently, I work at Temporal Technologies, at the startup that is focusing on building a workflow engine for code-first workflows to automate a lot of things. And before joining Temporal, I spent like forever at Microsoft, various groups like from servers, embedded, eventually going to cloud and building cloud technologies with kind of angle on actors and streaming and highly biased towards gaming scenarios where like event base is very important.
Ray, maybe you can introduce yourself next.
Yeah, let me introduce myself. Hi, everybody. My name is Raymond Roestenburg. I'm a tech lead at Lightbend. I'm a member of the Akka team, where I work on Akka serverless, Akka platform, and related technologies. I'm specialized in event-based systems, highly scalable distributed systems, and data streaming in those areas. And I've been working with event-based and streaming for about 15 years, and I counted the other day the JVM. I've been using the JVM for 25 years or so. So that was a quarter of a century, right? So,
wow.
I wrote a book on Akka, Akka in Action. There's a second edition now available for early access. So if that's fun for you, go check it out. But it's done by a colleague of mine. I was done with the book writing, but that's what I do nowadays.
Great. Thank you for joining.
Thanks.
Yeah, maybe I'll start with, I think there's lots of talk about the Lambda architecture a few years ago, where we would have parallel batch systems and real-time systems. And there's a lot of tension in that, especially, maintaining, data models and code that does, aggregations or these kind of things in two parallel systems is a real burden. And even say answering certain queries across those two systems becomes a huge problem. So I think there was maybe a notion that we would, as we move to a purely event-based systems, purely real-time systems, that we can kind of do away with the batch system. But in my experience, that isn't the case, and we're still living with batch systems. So do you also see that? And do you have opinions on how batch systems and real-time systems are maybe complementary?
Yeah, I mean, I can start if you're okay with it, Sergey. I think they are complementary. I think in many cases, I think Lambda in some shape or form is still used. People obviously want to move away from the complexity of these systems. But for instance, in machine learning, it makes a lot of sense to have training on your larger historical data, and then do inference scoring, the inference or scoring, as people call it, on the streaming information that passes by. So that's a very useful way for using a Lambda-like architecture. There's obviously has been a lot of work in trying to figure out a better architecture that is simpler to use and that removes some of the duplication in the code. And you know, that's very well known, sort of written about in the Kappa architecture, and which is very often used with Kafka. There is a Delta architecture, which is something that Databricks is doing with Delta tables, and they are basically making it very easy for you to do upserts on top of very, you know, very large historical data. So upserting real-time information on top of existing data. But and at the same time, it also depends on how you look at streaming. You can look at streaming from a in-application sort of operation, or as a data-oriented sort of ETL pipeline. So there's quite a few different areas in which you could use streaming, of course. If we're talking about streaming between microservices, it's, for me, it's quite different from the streaming case where you're doing ETL and you're basically purifying data and doing sort of ML ops or, you know, machine learning kind of systems. So
I kind of generally agree. I think these are complementary scenarios, and they come from optimizing for different things, right? So the batch systems will always be much more efficient than kind of granularity or per event. It's more expensive, but the latency requirements or capabilities go way down. And it can be much more contextualized. It can be like more rapid than reacting. I don't know whether it's device operations, some alerts, or a financial transaction like fraud prevention. Another factor I see is that there are different kinds of tooling, right? So like for people that do like Hadoop, like Hive queries, or like machine learning, it's a different skill than writing kind of standing queries in kind of more real-time systems. And again, they're complementary. I think Lambda, like, I mean, none of these technologies die, right? Like I was at Costco the other day and I saw some problem. I saw they're still using AS400 as a backend. Yeah. So like, I'm sure Lambda will stay for a long time. I think Kappa may be like more what I've been saying like recently, where there is some ingestion layer where things go through the streaming system, but then they diverge and go one fork of it goes into more real time. The other goes literally into like blob to create batch and like for system. So some kind of cross between Lambda and Kappa. I think it's more kind of what's popular.
Okay. Yeah, I definitely see like in our work, things like late reporting IoT devices is, and doing certain types of aggregations, say like a daily rollup and these kind of things are just much easier in batch systems, or more reliable in batch systems, easier to iterate on in batch systems than in purely event-based systems. I think a lot of the tension there is how do you maintain, say, data models or code that maybe you're doing aggregations or derivations and those kind of things. Do you have experience, or have you seen people having success maybe managing data governance or code governance across systems when they're doing, say, one thing in an event-based system in a real-time system, but then also bringing that maybe to their data warehouse or their batch systems?
What I've seen so far is that that's very often separate systems. It's easier to do it that way. Very often the real-time processing, because of what you just said, the possibilities for aggregation are different. If you're having batch, or you can do more query-like things, right? You can do, and there's far more state available. So the moment you're doing stateful processing, it makes a lot of sense to have batch or micro-batch, right? So for instance, you know, Spark on top of Parquet, those kind of systems. Where on the real-time side, you keep memory, maybe you keep stuff in memory, but it's more transient, if you will. So it's more you're processing, you keep some information, but you can't bring the whole world in there because then it will take too long to stay in real time. So the actual logic will be different. So even though it might seem like you're duplicating, what's being duplicated is very often the schemas and the data formats, if you will. So there is I need to combine both the real and the real time and the historical data. So there's a similarity there, but I think the logic is very often quite different.
I agree with that. If you look from in the developer experience, if you make a change, speaking about schema evolution and evolution of kind of systems, for real time, you have different constraints. We do like rollout of the new version of your streaming system. Like you cannot usually go back much further back and reprocess. While in the batch system, you can say, hey, let's go a month back or even like a year in some cases and reprocess everything. The other difference I saw is that real-time systems are much less concerned with data protection and governance laws, but in the batch system, like you have to think upfront how you're going to delete this data or how you're going to prove that you handle it correctly. In real-time, they're more ephemeral, and you kind of have aggregates or some products persisted that are less subject to that.
Yeah. I think this is a particularly interesting subject area, actually. You have a lot of decisions being made in real-time systems that then aren't necessarily represented historically. So you can imagine in some kind of operational technology where, you know, an operator or an algorithm makes a certain decision based on real-time data, but that's actually not persisted, and you can't actually audit or evaluate how the system made its decision. I think it's actually quite interesting. One of the challenges I keep seeing over and over again in event-based systems is that there's a chain of events that happen when we get an event. You can see that in Astrid's talk as well. There's a time component to things. It's not just we've made a decision to discharge a battery, but we want it to follow this profile over time and maybe have other triggers in the system that are dependent on it. So it blows up into this essentially workflow. There's a workflow defined through a series of events that trigger it. And of course, that there's implications there for state management, whether that's, you know, state of devices or whether that's some kind of notion of timing and retries or giving up on things or event windowing, watermarks that are used in streaming systems, these kind of things. So I know that's close to your heart, Sergey, and what you've been working on recently. What do you think the state of the art is for workflow management in event-based systems?
Yeah, I'm not sure I can claim something as state of the art, but I think what you point into is very the key question, because data needs to be processed in the context, and that context is like a user, a device, some session, and within that context you have like recent history, you have timing, which is much harder to reason about in the context of millions of users or devices. And this is where you trade the efficiency of batching for less efficient processing, but much more easy to understand and reason about it and evolve that kind of processing. Like you mentioned, you have the watermarks and some events that happened a certain time ago. This is where like, it goes into this workflow. It's business, you can call it workflow business process, into some set of rules that say, okay, if this happens three times and then if time more than X, do this action. And then you can change that logic. And somebody reviewing this change will understand, okay, we adjusted this way. And maybe I'm biased towards more like the real time and more like contextualized processing and the kind of small scale. Versus batch, but that's kind of where I'm thinking about. I don't know if that answers your question.
Yeah, I haven't seen a lot of, I guess maybe talking about the developer experience there. It's like there are, say, certain engines for managing workflows. I haven't seen developers get that excited about using these, and they often become quite constraining after a certain point. It's, you know, you get a POC, it's okay, but especially if you're driving real-time services, like, you know, imagine bidding into the energy market and these kind of things. So those say workflow engines haven't served people that well. And then I've also seen people that don't even go near that stuff, and they're essentially building their own workflow engine from scratch. and dealing with all these hard problems. How do you see that evolving? Do you think the developer experience in terms of event-based workflow will get better and we'll be building on top of platforms that serve those needs?
Oh boy, this is a hot topic actually. So like, and I think the contention is between code first versus kind of declarative or like data-driven definition of workflows. And I think I'm squarely in the code first camp because there like the developer writes code and then can reason and can debug code what's going on versus things that define first simple, like it used to be like XML, like XAML or like YAML, all those things, they look simple. Like you said, in POC, we have like three steps and then add more, but then they evolve over time. And before you know, you have this huge blob of some kind of like DSL, ad hoc DSL. And it's very difficult to figure out what went wrong. And kind of developer experience, and especially dealing with failures, I think is paramount and is often underestimated when people get into this. Oh, I'll just write some DSL and like handle it. And then 2 years later, like somebody who inherited the system, they cannot manage it. They next like leave it as is. So my bias is squarely towards like code first or code based to be developer friendly.
For me as well. I mean, I've always been in the code first camp, so I would agree with you there, Sergey. And I've seen a lot of systems where people start using a few Kafka topics at first, and then they get more and more Kafka topics, and then over time it becomes very difficult to track where everything goes. And you can obviously add all kinds of logging, all kinds of tracing, kind of stuff. But it's definitely not a simple thing. So being able to easily debug and have a good developer experience is, I think, something that the future will hopefully brings us.
Yeah. It's funny, on the very same visit to Costco, I mentioned what I saw AS400, I ran into an old friend of mine who is working at this huge payment processing company. And he was telling exactly the story, Ray, you mentioning that he was reviewing architecture of systems and services, and people ask what's wrong, and he sees this, like, okay, it starts with Kafka topic, and then it gets into dead letter queue, and then there's like three layers of dead letter queues and some ad hoc logic to deal with that, because yeah, it's simple from the start before like you get into this real life cases.
I'm definitely dealing with this. Of, you know, you transition fully into these event-based architectures, often largely around some kind of messaging system at the core. And, you know, each new problem you have, like wanting a dead letter queue or something like that, you produce back to Kafka, something like that, and then you tackle on one more layer. And it reminds me a little bit of the third talk in the track of kind of this microservice sprawl comes first. And then you need to figure out solutions to kind of for data governance, for federation, for solving the hard problems. And yeah, I'm not sure we've quite got there yet with event-based systems. How do you see that evolving? Maybe with say a company who's standardized on Kafka and it's pretty easy to create a new service against it or create a new topic. And you know, eventually that becomes fairly intertwined. It's hard to tell where events are going. It's hard to change the system over time. What are there companies that are doing that well, and what are the techniques they're using?
Radio
or maybe none of us are doing
yeah,
it well.
Yeah, I can go for it. Well, I mean, there are different things that you can do, though eventually you have to build up a picture of what's going on, right? So you can imagine a whole bunch of topics with processing parts in between, and you need to understand where things go. So one of the things that you can do is in the metadata or the header information. So like similar to like cloud events, for instance, you can put information, contextual information about what the message was, but you would still have to sort of extract that from every topic and then build up a bigger picture. So the same thing you can do with log tracing systems, right? Where you can see which component called which, etc. But this is definitely not easy to do, and you have to sort of start doing it from the beginning. So you have to. This is one of the issues, or one of the difficulties with event-based systems. You have to, from the beginning, you have to build things in. because otherwise you can't later on see what's going on. And for instance, one very simple thing, if you have a processor that reads from a topic and writes to another topic, when you're processing from that topic and you get any corruption, you basically have the only option you have is to drop the message and to continue, because otherwise your system is stuck. You know, you have a poisoned queue. And the dead letter queues that you mentioned very often are not very useful because it was corrupted data. Now, how are you going to read this? So it leads to a lot of human intervention. You would have to go to previous versions of code to see what it was, maybe. So by that time, your system is already a lot further, right? So these interactions become very difficult. But yeah, I think building up more context per message and keeping this context with the message or inside the message itself in the domain event itself or as metadata on the message can help you to later on create a picture of what's going on. But as you can understand, the moment you lose a message, that's something you don't see. So it's very difficult to then see where did everything go. And then you can, you know, I haven't seen any like stream lineage tools or something that really can just very automatically trace back to where things began and how it fanned out or something. That I haven't seen that yet so far, but maybe Sergey has seen some of these tools.
We see the bunch of the things in with customers. So we started referring to them on a queues and duct tape kind of architecture, where like the queues by themselves are great, but this challenge of right, what you alluded to, like when there is a poison message or just pure failure, like to talk to another system, which may be down or maybe like there's some interrupt and retries, exponential backups, back pressure. So this set of concerns are pretty standard when you go from like one stage to another or from one microservice to another.
Yeah.
And kind of challenge there is to have a simple to use, unambiguous kind of set of tools for developers that, which will be very clear what the behavior of the system would be without writing code for this sort of duct tape. So have duct tape be part of the system, and then you can reason about what's going on and you can trace what's going on by looking at kind of standardized, unified way of, okay, here's the progress of this processing within the context. I think context comes first.
Mm-hmm. Then, yeah.
Maybe I'll pick up on a few of the questions in chat, because it kind of continues on from these ideas. So, you know, maybe back to that context when you let's maybe think of a workflow, an event-based workflow that has lots of this context, maybe applied to, you know, to an IoT scenario when you have millions of them. How do we get visibility into kind of state management, workflow progress, those kind of things when that is defined not as a single instance, but say millions of them?
Well, I hate to say that it depends on scenario, right? Because yeah. In some scenarios, like in IoT, there may be transient state that it's okay because there'll be subsequent update, maybe like a minute later, that will invalidate the previous state anyway. So like, it's not important to alert in this case. Or like a telemetry, like another example where like there may be some hiccup in telemetry, some metrics, and generally at high volume it's okay because they keep like being reissued. But there are different scenarios, like kind of payment transactions where it's absolutely unacceptable to handle them way, and then you need to alert, and then you need to stop processing, and maybe even like page developer, like engineer, to go figure out.
Are you seeing anybody use cloud events to solve the metadata problems that we were just talking about, of, you know, traceability of events or correlating events to certain actions?
I don't. Maybe people do that, but I've not myself seen that.
Well, yeah, we are using cloud events for inside like a serverless, for instance, and there is some additional information that we keep. But it's not necessarily meant at this point in any case to extend for this kind of information. But I think I mean, you could use Kafka's normal headers as well, right? It's not necessarily cloud events. You could use anything. Although it is handy to have a particular format that you keep, you know, for all your stuff, whatever you're doing. So you can very easily inspect. Okay, now if I put everything in a cloud event, then I can very easily see at least some of these metrics, some of these things, some of these headers. The other thing you could obviously do is, in your stateful processing, keep information about what's going on and then provide that in telemetry again. So it's very case-by-case basis. It depends on what you want to do.
I think telemetry is key. Like, if you emit enough telemetry, then you can separate kind of systemic issues versus some kind of one-off things, and then you can decide where you want to invest time.
Yeah.
But that's been my experience. I think cloud events sounds very interesting, but I haven't seen much adoption of it. I've seen more what you're mentioning, Ray, with like using Kafka headers or even Kafka off, mm-hmm. propagating request IDs even all the way through Kafka. So like you can even tie, say, a gRPC or an HTTP request to an event that ended up in Kafka that got processed later on to do something.
Yeah. And you could do it inside your messages or outside as a header, sort of depends. But the nice thing about if you put it on the headers is that they are always readable. So you wouldn't get a corrupt header, right? Oh, if something really horrible would happen in Kafka, maybe. But that's the benefit of using these sort of envelopes, if you will.
And I've seen people with wanting to do transactional things actually using the Kafka offsets and propagating those as metadata so that you can go, especially when like an event to another topic, to another topic, to another topic, is if you maintain the original offset, then you can actually do some transactional things against that, which is kind of interesting.
We've done that, but mostly from the topic where you're producing, where you're processing the topic. That's where you do it, and you write to the output. So when you write to any output, even to a database, you can write in a transaction. You write the offset where you were left off. So in that way, you can do, effectively once kind of processing within that service. Yep. But it's very hard, or I must rather say, I don't know how to do that over many services. So one of those hops is fine, and you can build these. Services that can sort of die at any time, continue where they left off. And, you might have to deal with some duplication, but in the case where you write out the offsets to the output where you're writing, if that has a transactional model, then you can be effectively once basically for processing.
Yeah, same here. I've seen it within the scope of a service, but kind of crossing service boundaries are usually different mechanism.
Yeah.
Maybe talk a bit about the developer experience and ecosystem. So like a lot of event-based systems, they have their own libraries or they have their own developer experience. I think of Kafka and Kafka Streams and the systems people build around that. I mean, most of my experience in the last 5 years has been using Akka Streams, even around Kafka, because I can interface with all sorts of different systems and I'm not just tied into one ecosystem. Do you think that's a model that will continue to evolve in libraries in lots of different languages? Or do you think there's certain advantages of having ecosystem specific libraries? Do you have opinions there? What are you seeing develop?
Yeah, I definitely have opinions, but I'll let Sergey take it first, I think.
Sure. My opinion here is that what's most important is establishing patterns. And kind of what you look at Kafka did, it established this is the way to do it. It's essentially the partition log, right? It's not even the queuing system. And for example, when I had to explain years ago what Azure Event Hubs is, I essentially hosted Kafka. Like it's the same kind of thing, like the Kinesis, right? So like establishing this pattern, and then people can use different services like that in the same manner, and then switching from library to library, so long as they're speaking kind of the same language in terms of abstractions, I think it's easy. Trying to unify it into one layer that hides everything, I think that's dangerous. And And I think we made that mistake, like in the early streaming back in the days when we provided a single interface for queuing systems with very different semantics, like log-based versus kind of SQS, Azure queue, versus even like in-memory, like TCP direct messages. So yeah. I think that's a dangerous thing to try to hide that.
Yeah, I definitely agree with that. I think it's very good to take advantage of these very specific libraries. There's and you know, streaming is not streaming. You know, there's so many different things you can do. You can do the what you said with Active Streams, which obviously I like, but it's a particular kind of in-application streaming that you do there. The moment you want to do sort of data-oriented streaming, and it's a whole different thing. Like, for instance, Active Streams doesn't have things like windowing, watermarks. It's possible to build those things, but they're far better supported in let's say, Spark or Flink, which are completely different models. So you basically need specific libraries. And, you know, I don't think it's a place inside a programming language. You know, that's always, that's a danger as well. To expect that of the programming language, it's a very specific need if you look further than just memory constraints, processing of data, right?
I'll pick up on the question. Are you seeing any use of Apache Beam for as the model for solving some of those problems?
I sadly have not. I've always been hoping for seeing Apache Beam being used more. I do see things like Flink, but the actual standard of Apache Beam being used is not something I have seen. I was expecting it maybe, but.
Yeah, I'm not even familiar with it.
That's a very nice standard for these things, for this.
Maybe let's talk maybe about the evolution of these systems. So like, I think a lot of events first systems, streaming systems, people have built those, and I've lots of experience with actors over the last many years. I know both of you have a lot of experience with actor-like. I know, Sergey, you wrote an article saying that it's such a loaded term, it's hard to use sometimes. Most of what I build is we run it ourselves. We're building these, distributed, stateful, actor systems that model entities, and we're building it ourselves. It seems like more recently we're starting to see this evolution on top of cloud platforms with, Azure Durable Functions or the Cloudflare Durable Objects. It seems like this kind of location transparent, stateful actor model is almost becoming the way of programming the cloud in the future. Do you agree? And what do you think that evolution is in terms of developer experience for building event-based systems?
That's been kind of my belief that it would come to that, the serverless kind of hosted, cloud-hosted systems based on the actor or context-oriented computations. And I think it's inevitable because there's this data gravity, right? And yes, you can deploy, you run your own replicated databases in the whole estate, but most people don't want to. They want to outsource this problem. Then it comes to hosting your compute. Of course, we can all run on Kubernetes clusters. Do we want to becomes the question if it's cost effective to run it in the cloud provider? And then before you know, like you outsource most of this kind of platform you're concerned to focus on the actual application, like the main.
Yeah.
So I think that's inevitable for a lot of scenarios, if not for most. That would be much easier, more economical to just run it in the cloud.
Yeah, I think, in many cases, you want to really focus. I mean, in all cases, you want to focus on your business. And a lot of these systems, which are wonderful, they are also very hard to run. Kafka is quite notorious in this respect. And, you can get these kind of distributed logs, Pulsar, Kafka, you can get them run for you. And nowadays, even with like infinite storage, tiered storage, those things are very hard to set up yourself. So even if you would be able to manage a Kafka cluster, how are you going to set up all of this sort of extra stuff that you need to not run out of space. And a similar thing you can see with, that's a Google Spanner, where there's also like infinite amount of storage. And there, I think it's very interesting that people people love assets, right? I mean, transactions, in the sense of simplicity. And that comes back as well in what Databricks is doing with the Delta Lake stuff. So I think people are moving towards, okay, it's very interesting, all these technologies, but I want to focus on a simple model and have a lot of the ops taken care of for me, instead of having to deal with all these complexities.
One other thing I forgot to mention is compliance. Like if you host it yourself, getting SOC 2 compliance or other compliance, just pain in the, you know, or, but yeah, if it's outsourced, then you just present their SOC 2 documents and you're good.
Even security to some extent will be better arranged than what you're going to do yourself.
Right.
Although there's still obviously always a big open problem there. But
apparently we only have 5 minutes left and I haven't even got most of my questions answered. So I'm trying to decide what to pick last. Maybe back to workflows and I hope most people are familiar with the saga pattern of, you know, kind of the notion of compensating transactions and taking care of things when they fail. Is that actually being successfully applied? My impression is that most people that try this learn that it's actually really difficult to apply the saga pattern correctly, and that there is really no such thing as rolling back the world. You can compensate in certain ways sometimes, but you can't go backwards.
Yeah, I'm not sure I agree with you actually, Colin. So like, yeah, it's compensation. Like you're not rolling the clock back. Like, and then this classic example of reservations, yeah, you can cancel through reservations and one of them failed or got declined. So I think there's nothing wrong with the saga as a pattern. I think saga is kind of restricted case of a general kind of workflow. It's like, what do you want to do if this step in your business logic fails, right? And saga just say, oh, you unwind what you've allocated before. But in a more general case, you might want to do something else. So like, I don't see that as a kind of necessarily special separate case that different from a normal workflow.
I guess what I've seen is that depending on the state that you arrive in, you can't actually compensate. Like, you know, the reason you can't move forward is kind of also the reason you can't compensate, and you get, it's almost like head of line blocking again. You're kind of stuck.
But that's fine, right? Because in this case, like in a general workflow logic, you need to have a step or a case for like notifying, like saying, hey, this thing needs to be manually handled or call manager, right, or something.
Right.
It's a more general kind of escape hatch for something that it cannot progress automatically or on the kind of predefined simple logic.
I think one of the issues is that you really have to keep it in the business domain, so in the logic of the business. And so modeling things as sagas purely in the business domain makes sense, because you can have these different scenarios. You know, you compensate or you continue. The really tricky part is if you might be confused with the fact that you could use sagas for intermittent errors or something, or, you know, technical errors. So the service wasn't there, right? And then you might have already called it, so you might have already reserved that table. You just didn't get a response back. So on the business level, where you have more context, you can then say, well, this workflow ends because something went wrong and I'm just going to get someone to look at it. If you try to solve the technical problem with the saga, then you're going to be in a big problem, right?
So yeah, I think it's very
good. Modeling the business is a, yeah.
Great. I think we have to leave it there and head to the hallway discussion. I wish we could go on for a lot longer. I really thank you both for participating in this session. And I know you've worked in event-based systems for years, and you've also shared a lot of your work. So I look forward to continuing to hear you speak and write, and and so that we can continue to learn how to solve these hardest problems of event-based systems. So thanks again for joining today.
Thank you, Colin, Ray. It was a pleasure.